got so many different species.
And they'll probably give us a little bit of a rodeo while we're handling them.
This is a lot of sharks all at once. It's a tiny bit of stress.
We're gonna hope for the best.
I'm Jasmin Graham, marine biologist and shark scientist, and I'm here in Biscayne Bay for the first day of our Diversifying Ocean Sciences workshop. It's a year-long program where students learn all about ocean science. And then they get to apply those skills for a week-long intensive hands-on experience aboard the Garvin. Today we'll be doing what's called a shark survey, where we'll go out, catch and release some sharks, take some samples, which we will use to understand the health of the population here. This helps us better understand the species that are here, how plentiful they are, and study the human impacts facing sharks in this area. There's a lot of really incredible species found here, several of which actually use Biscayne Bay as a nursery ground for their young. Nursery grounds are super important for endangered species because if you have a healthy nursery, you have sharks making it to adulthood, reproducing, and replenishing the population. We really need to find some little baby black tips. Again, adorable, we love baby sharks, and it would be really nice to get some data for that species. Participants are gonna learn a lot of really cool things. They're gonna learn how to do what's called a long line. They're gonna learn how to set drum lines. They're gonna learn how to take scientific data from sharks, including measurements, tagging, fin clips, muscle biopsy, and they'll also get to watch how we draw blood. Today, we're doing one of our shark surveys.
Hey guys, I'm Amani. I'm also one of the co-founders of Minorities in Shark Sciences.
It is an honor to us at Minorities in Shark Sciences to provide these opportunities.
I'm from Bangalore. It's a landlocked city. In underdeveloped countries like India, you can't do a lot of live shark based research because of funding that we receive there or the kind of platforms that we have. So this workshop is like really cool. To be very close to a live shark, I'm pretty nervous to handle them, but equally I want to like collect good scientific data that can help improve scientific, you know, the knowledge within the world.
All of our Diversifying Ocean Sciences participants are early career emerging scientists that are eager to get into the field of ocean research.
We're gonna be long lining, and typically with this type of fishing, we'll usually catch smaller sharks. So one of the things that I really hope we catch is a black nose. These are a little bit of a smaller species. They often have this little black splotch on their nose. Another shark that we might catch is a smaller black tip. The dead giveaway for these guys is that their fins will have black tips on them. That is really beautiful gray kind of lateral stripe right on the side of their body. We also might find a nurse shark, which I absolutely love. They're just completely brown. They have really kind of flat faces. And the last species that we may or may not catch is a bonnethead. They have that cephalofoil, but it's shaped like a little bonnet, and they are incredibly tiny in comparison to the larger hammerhead.
All right, so for this demonstration, we are going to use our friend Vanna White Shark here so we can work the shark up as fast as possible, get them back in the water. So very important, this is the bitey end, this is the slappy end, this is where you live, right here, away from the bitey end and away from the slappy end. So we take the fin clip from the dorsal fin and we use that for genetics. And then the next job is tagging. It's sort of like an identification number. So the way that we do this, we have our tagger. So we push in and then we'll just give that a little tug, make sure that it's stuck in there. And then one more time, you're gonna wanna read that number out nice and loud for the data person. And that's how you work the shark.
So this is the tuna clip. We're gonna be clipping that on to the black line. So here we have our anchor. You're gonna go travel across this line. You're gonna see a red part of the line. this is what buoys are gonna be attached to. So we're gonna have a buoy on each side with a tuna clip on it, and then we're gonna let it go out while we are setting it.
So we just set our two long lines, and we are waiting. They're soaking for about an hour, and we'll go and haul them in, see what we get. All that being said, who knows what we're gonna catch? Who knows if we catch anything? That's why they call it fishing, not catching. Tiburon, tiburon. So here we have a black nose. Chris is about to draw blood.
What?
There's someone with a stopwatch that records to help measure stress physiology. So we're going to have someone take a biopsy, a little muscle tissue sample, which we can use to look at stable isotopes and also toxins in the sharks. We will put a tag in it and take a fin clip for genetics. This part of the shark doesn't have as many neuroreceptors as, say, our bodies, and it's not an evolutionary advantage for them. So they've evolved to not feel as much as we do. And we will do second blood to look at how its stress went up or down from the workup, and then we will release it. And right now we have a line of sharks, so there are two sharks behind this one. It's trying to move a little fast because we've got a traffic jam, so to speak.
GL66.
It's important to move fast. Some sharks are what we call obligate ram ventilators, meaning they have to keep swimming to breathe. There are other sharks that can buccal pump, like nurse sharks and lemon sharks, where they can just sit on the bottom and they use their muscles and their cheeks to pull water over their gills so they don't have to swim. So our obligate ram ventilators need that PVC pipe in to simulate how it would be if they were swimming. They do have water flowing over their gills, so they're getting oxygen, but their bodies are designed to be in water, so they're actually feeling more gravity than they're used to when they're out of water. So we try to move pretty quickly, trying to get them back in the water so that they can go on and live their lives.
Another one.
They got that platform nurse shark on this long line.
This is a lot of sharks all at once. It's a tiny bit of stress.
We have another one that needs to skip the line here. 101 for FL.
No, there is moments where things are gonna get a little.
So that's good.
When things are gonna get a little hectic and stressful.
It wasn't terrible. It wasn't that bad. It was a little stressful.
Grab the fin clip to look at its genetics and learn more about it now. But yeah, it wasn't that bad. It's not. I feel at peace right now.
Now we have a black tip, a big chonky black tip. So black tips get to be much larger than the black noses. My favorite thing about these black tips, they have this very pretty little like Z for Zorro on the side of their body. They're really cool.
So we just saw a black tip, which happened to be a retag. And I absolutely love when we get retags. This means that we tagged it previously, either this year or another year, in this case of that black tip. We tagged it back in April of 2019, and we just caught it today in 2023. And with all of the data that we've been taking all week, one of the things that we can see is how much the shark has grown. So I always really love when we get a recapture because it really gets to kind of bring that data collection full circle and see kind of how they're growing and how they're behaving and if they're actually staying in the area.
It's really exciting, especially having like that direct contact with a shark. And so it's a really special moment for you when you like, oh, this is what I want to do, this is what I like. So yeah, it's a crucial moment in your life, I think.
That's for sure.
Sadly, our time has come to a close. But this is see you later, not goodbye. Keep us up to date on what you do, where you go.
I had no idea that I was gonna get the hands-on experience that I did. There was plenty of times that I was like scared or nervous. It was more of like the excitement and being able to learn like kind of overruled my nervousness and fear. But it was a great experience overall. each step of the way, there was always someone there next to me to help me.
My very first time that I got to see a first live shark was when I came to US here as part of Miss Fellowship. This was my first time to do a lot of these techniques. It's an opportunity that the Miss has created for me. Just having to fly all the way from India to US, like, which took me almost 2 years. I'm not a person who would like scream or screech out about my enjoyment, but deep down I was like crying because I got to see my first shark. It's also a lot of different emotions, which I really don't know how to express about them. So that's how it felt.
Yeah, I always find it so fun when people see their first shark and that initial smile that they get just brings me so much joy.
Yeah, especially since we got so many different species. That's pretty rad. And I think that they learned a lot too.
Which I feel like was an exciting experience for them.
Yeah, I think that these types of workshops are so meaningful, especially just getting to have a bunch of people of color and women on the boat.
Oh, yeah.
As your first experience.
Yeah, I can't imagine.
That's so rare.
I think things would have been so amazing if my first experience had been like this, where it's just a bunch of women of color.
Especially to have mentors that look like you, like just so impactful.
It makes me really happy, especially when students tell us that they're excited and that they didn't think about it as a career path, because it just makes me feel like we're actually making a change and like doing something that we wanted to do when we started.
We're really excited. We had several people that were like, oh, I never really thought about sharks, but you just opened up all of these possibilities. I'm like, it worked!
Yes!
I think that they're gonna go far.